breakfast puppies?
This podcast contains adult language and content and is meant for mature audiences. Listener discretion is advised.
We're all set to begin, so let's dive right in to bikers, dice, and bars. Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like. You can listen to it in your cars, but mostly it's about dive bars. Bikers, dice, and bars.
Hey, Xander, what are we drinking now?
We have switched it up a little bit to a different type of McMenamin's whiskey. McMenamin's has two distilleries in the company. One is at Edgefield, where I work. The other one is at the Cornelius Pass Roadhouse, which makes this delightful whiskey, which is the Billy Rye whiskey, aged for 4 years in new American oak barrels. It is bottled in bond, courtesy of your United States government. And comes in at 100 proof, and they use this in a 100-year antique cognac still from France.
Bottled by bond.
What bottled in mean? Bond.
Bottled in bond?
James Bond, Jr. Sorry.
So I believe 1890-something, 93, 96, something like that. A lot of the American distillers that made, you know, good whiskey were upset that people were making shitty whiskey, and they lobbied Congress to go and create the Bottled and Bond Act, which was a certification of quality of whiskey by your United States government.
Huh, fascinating.
That amongst other things, assured that it had to be at least 100 proof, that all of the grain had to come from the same field, from the same harvest, from the same year, and
dang.
Couple of the things too, but like it was like a kind of a serious thing. So it was, if it's bottled in bond, like this government certification that this whiskey fucking rules.
Amazing.
So this is rye. It's gonna be a little bit spicier because that's kind of how rye works. And I'll go and just read the description that the distillers give. Coming at you, sweetheart. Our century-old alambic cognac still. The palate reaches new heights of flavor and aroma. Plain on the rich molasses and oak with a long spicy finish. The spicy finish is what you're going to go and get from any type of rye whiskey that's worth its merit.
Speaking of a spicy finish, you're listening to Bikers, Dice, and Bars, recorded in Portland, Oregon. I'm NPC.
I'm just Jacob. I just empty chair over there.
The good Dr. Xander Gerrymander.
I am Poppy Beaujolais.
And if you haven't figured out, Jacob is once again not with us.
I'm just Jacob.
Now, we're also drinking the Ghost Rabbit Pilsner.
It's tasty.
And again, I'm not a Pilsner guy. I shit on Pilsners all the time. I think they're the beer of garbage people. However, this particular Pilsner, as Poppy has flipped me off from across the table, is actually quite delightful, crisp, and refreshing. All things that most Pilsners are not. Because of German purity laws, they tend to be stupid. So
we had a Pilsner on a few recordings ago that you liked too. And I remember very specifically it was because it didn't taste like a Pilsner. I don't remember what it was though.
Yeah.
We'll have to go back and listen.
Okay.
Oh no.
It wasn't Frem?
No. Something I think Jacob brought.
Yeah. I mean, this actually has all the qualities that I would like in a nice light beer. It has crispness. It is light on the palate. It doesn't taste like it's been aged in a green bottle that's been left out in the sun. Looking at you, most of the Pilsners out there, what the fuck is wrong with you? Seriously, Europe, get your shit together. So I'm just going to go and hand it to the McMenamin's Brewers that made the Ghost Rabbit Pilsner. You did a good job and made what a Pilsner probably should taste like.
And I think it's love Pilsners. Pilsners and lagers, man, it's where it's at.
It's your right to be wrong.
You know what? Freaking Californian.
Listen, Coloradan.
I'm talking like my actual Midwestern Illinois roots, yo. Like Pilsner, man, all the way.
Well, let's bring this to the bar, specifically the bars that are now reopened under, COVID, I think, is sort of settling, depending upon who you talk to. But the governor has finally reopened the state, and bars are back to semi-full, if not full, occupancy. Xander, you're the man on the ground. Tell us about your experience in this old new this new, in this old, new, old,
new world. Old world.
Yeah.
So bars in Multnomah County, at least, I think in the whole state of Oregon, are back at full capacity if they want to be. I did go to a Chinese joint earlier, and they were very weird about people sitting next to each other that didn't know each other, which is kind of an unusual thing. It might just be because they're Chinese-owned and sensitive to certain things about a certain ex-president and certain stupid shit he said. But again, for the most part, bars are open to 100% capacity. Restaurants are open to 100% capacity in this state. Some of the like weird sneeze guard things are still kind of up in bars. Depends on where you go. Mm-hmm. But basically, it's a maskless society again for the most part, and it feels good yet still weird to get back to normal. There was a awful transition period between that when the governor said, well, you know, if you're fully vaccinated and you want to show your vaccine card, you can show it to your bartender. They can say you don't have to wear your mask anymore. But of course, you walked into the bar without your mask to begin with because the governor made us the COVID police because fuck her. And
not what you signed up for.
I did not sign up to be the COVID police. And it was like this whole just weird, the couple month transition between like fully mask, semi mask, mostly not mask, and then not mask at all was a very messy, very frustrating period of time to deal with because she put all the onus on bartenders and servers and hosts and whatnot for that kind of thing. And then, you know, the grocery stores were just like, fuck it, just fuck it, like just straight up. But they made us check vaccine cards, which was like, come on, really? Really?
Well, and again, I want to circle back to something you said, which was if they want to be, right? All of these bars, restaurants, stores, et cetera, they are private property. They can make whatever fucking rules they want to about entering their building so long as it is not racist or sexist or ableist, et cetera, et cetera.
And the fun thing, too, was that HIPAA does not pertain to me as a bar. And people are so fucking stupid. Well, what about HIPAA, man? I'm sorry, I'm not your doctor. I'm not another hospital, so I can ask for those things. Yeah, what I can ask for those things.
Yeah.
Well, because people are dumb for the most part, and they just wanted to go and like, you're violating my rights. I'm like,
The one that I loved hearing the most from people, like I would overhear when I went somewhere. HIPAA says I don't have to. Like,
no. HIPAA says that. So health. Information Portability and Privacy Act. Look it up, motherfuckers. Okay.
Does that mean I have to read?
I mean, you can, so you should.
Rude. So, yeah, the initial rollout of all of the relaxed COVID restrictions were kind of a pain in the tits just because of the fact that it put all the onus on service industry workers, whether they were in grocery stores, restaurants, bars, you know, salons, barbers, whatever the fuck it was. It was just like, well, you should check because those are the new guidelines. Good luck, guys. Hope the public doesn't go and beat the shit out of you for this. So I appreciate that, Governor Brown. That was really nice of you.
Sarcasm.
Wee-oo. That was a sarcasm alert. And then... She said, once we hit 70%, we'll go back to mask-free. She got to like 69.1 and then just said, fuck it. We'll just go for it anyways.
Because it was tourist season.
Of course.
Of course.
Of course.
In a state with no sales tax.
Brilliant. And then what was even better was there was an article in the Oregonian that just came out yesterday that said the best way for Oregon to get maximum vaccine coverage is for Governor Brown to stop talking about it because it found that most people that had reservations because she kept talking about it. And her response was, I'm going to keep talking about it.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
I think we're in a brief, it is currently, as we are doing this podcast, it is middle of July, 2021. And we are in what I think is a brief respite with the Delta variant growing. We're in a brief respite period, but we're all vaccinated, so we should be fine.
That is what the science is saying. And I will tell you, too, that it's been an interesting experience going back to bars.
Yeah. Bars, restaurants, public locations in general has been a very strange experience.
I had a weird thing where I wanted to go to Dante's for us Inferno. It was the first week that weekend that things were open. Show up, there's a line on the around the block, and I'm like, okay, this is a bit much. By the time I get inside, it's already at capacity, like original capacity, which is like 300 or something like that. And I just went, I don't want to be here right now. Yeah. Like I'm like missing the days where my favorite band would come to town and only 150 people would show up. And I'm like, yeah, perfect. A half full venue. This fucking rules.
Those are the best.
Those are the best.
And now I'm like, oh, it's sold out and it's really crowded.
So
and
many people.
I don't want to be around all of you right now. Yeah. So that kind of got a little weird.
So Xander, I wonder, is that you, you know, is that due to lingering feelings from not wanting to be around crowds due to COVID? Or is it probably because you're getting old?
Well, no. What I think it is that when I would go to shows, I always would like it when there was maybe, you know, a half to like two thirds capacity. That's really all that it is. And even when I was young, I hated going to festivals. I hated it. Too many people. I don't. And this is why I'm so stoked that my eclectic and very sophisticated musical taste involves the fact that I don't listen to many bands. I actually have a big following, so I don't have to worry about this nonsense.
but you've probably never heard of them.
And you should, but you shouldn't. You should because they're great, and you shouldn't because then you'll be there and you'll be too crowded for me again. But no, I've never liked going to festivals. I've never liked going to big arenas. Like, it's just not my thing. It has to be an exceptionally rare musician or artist that's touring that will make me want to go and break that rule for me. So it's not that I'm getting old. It's just that I just don't like being around people.
I have to agree. It's not that I'm getting old. It's that I have, how do I put this? I already knew that people were really fucking disgusting. Having worked in retail for like 10 years, having worked in pediatrics, having worked in healthcare, having just existed in this world, people are really fucking disgusting. People don't know how to wash their fucking hands and cover their fucking coughs and sneezes.
If they wash their hands at all.
If they wash their hands at all. And people are fucking disgusting. The world is pretty fucking disgusting. And it just became so, so glaringly obvious in the last year by the amount of times I got sick, which was like one. And I think that anytime I called off from work for sick leave was like due to stress because of just cumulative stress. You know, wasn't necessarily like I had a virus or a cold or anything. It was just stress related. I think I had a bacterial infection exactly once. And I think I had a viral infection once in the last year, as opposed to like three viral infections a year normally.
Yeah, I had one heinous fever at one point, and that was it.
Yeah, and that was really weird because no one else in the house got sick.
No one else in the house got sick. It wasn't COVID.
Yeah.
It
was super weird.
It was just, I think it was just flu.
Yeah
I think I just had flu for a day.
Good old fashioned.
Whenever I get sick, it goes right through my system and then it's done. Like, I don't get sick for days. Like, whenever I've had the flu, the worst flu I ever had, I had the swine flu in 2009. Got it from PAX when that was going around, and it was intense, and I was down for 2 days, whereas my roommate was down for like 2 weeks.
Yeah. So yeah, going back to the bars has been a very interesting experience. And I recently went to Colorado to visit some family. It was my first plane ride since 2019. And I wore a surgical mask. I wore goggles. I did the best I could do, you know, and I didn't get plane crud. It was kind of incredible. But Colorado is so different. Like, Colorado is acting like the pandemic just didn't exist. Like, hardly anybody there wearing a mask. It was wild.
When did you go?
It was June 21st-ish.
Do you know when their governor lifted the mask mandate?
I don't.
Okay, that might have been why no one was wearing a mask. Mandate might have been lifted.
It was lifted. It was definitely lifted.
Yeah, so why would someone wear a mask if the mandate's lifted?
I know.
I still wear it from time to time. I got so used to wearing it that it's kind of convenient. I've got a stylish couple of masks with some cool things on it that are comfortable.
Yeah.
It means I don't have to shave. I don't have to have people, you know, smell my breath. It's all on me.
I feel kind of naked without a mask sometimes now. Yeah, yeah. Now it's weird.
It's kind of like a fashion accessory, I guess.
Yeah. It did grow into one for sure. I mean, I went to New York City in the first week of June. And like, I'll tell you, man, New York City is back, baby. And it was for the Fraternal Order of Bartenders meetup that I had. You know, it was a good trip. It was just so interesting to walk into bars again, especially out of state, you know. Mm-hmm. Because this is way before our mask mandate got lifted.
Yeah.
Because that was not until June 30th. This is the first week of June.
Okay.
In New York, isn't that where it hit the hardest in this country? Like, weren't they just like having like thousands of dead a day kind of thing?
Medical ships had to come in and like dock because their hospitals were full.
They had like the fucking body car, or the car is just full of frozen bodies. The refrigerators. The
refrigerated cars. Yeah. Yeah.
And they started mass graves again? Yeah, they did.
Yeah.
They did. And it was, I would say, about 80% open. The only place that masks were required were on like public transit and airports and stuff like that. Aside from that, it was like, nope, you're all good.
Yeah.
And it was a wild ride.
I bet.
But aside from that, this last month, basically, in Portland or Oregon in general, has been such a back and forth as far as what the governor felt like doing for us and what the mandates were. And she would change them up sometimes 3 times in a week. You know, she tried to pit herself as the I am the one who follows the science, and then would change her opinion twice in a week because of pressure she was getting. So like, well, clearly you're not, and that's okay. Just admit it, that you are a politician like the rest of them. You don't have to, you know, like don't Andrew Cuomo yourself.
I would love to have like a high ranking political official come right out and say, look, I'm only doing this because those fuckers sitting in that room over there told me to, and I'm tired of listening to them kind of thing. Like, just fess up.
A Bullworth moment.
You know, yes! That movie was so good. That movie was so,
Yeah, like the part where he goes to the black church. It's like, well, we listened to it for 4 years so we can get your vote, and we just ignore you because the other party's not going to do dick for you. And then we come back every 4 years and, you know, throw a little bit of crumbs some more. That's what we do.
As an unappreciated gem of a film.
I don't know if I've ever seen that one.
Oh, you should watch it sometime. Okay. It's kind of dated now, but it's so good.
Yeah. It's a really good dark comedy.
So I was gonna say, so Xander, what's it been like as a bartender? Like, you've talked about being the COVID police.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, like cleanliness wise, what has your routine changed at all? I mean, and for your own personal safety, how have you felt during this?
I was lucky enough to get my vaccine pretty early back in February. So like, as far as that, like, it was the second week I was back at work, I had my COVID vaccine, my first shot. And then the day after St. Patrick's Day, Lord have mercy. I got my second shot. But as far as cleanliness was concerned, this is what also frustrated me so much about shutting down bars and restaurants, is that they are some of the most hyper clean places anywhere in the public at all. It's not like a grocery store where someone goes and picks up these 5 apples and puts them back down again because they don't want one. Like, you don't go get a hamburger, touch it like 5 times and be like, no, I'll take this burger instead. Like, that shit doesn't happen. Things are made to order. We already had like, you know, bleach buckets and like, you know, quad solution and all these fucking cleaners that we wiped on the table every single time. We did that shit already. Mm-hmm. And even back as of October, the governor's own Oregon Health Authority could only contact trace like 0.75% of all COVID cases to bars, restaurants, and hotels. Mm-hmm. Because we already did a good job in cleaning. So,
because you have to, because of the food safety and cleanliness. Because
that's
already
how restaurants work.
Exactly. Like, it's just
infuriating. Like, we already wipe in the bars like 50 times a day. We wash our hands so goddamn often. Like, it's partially because you're dealing with syrups and it's sticky and whatnot, but also just because, like, you're touching stuff all the time.
Yeah, you're like touching something that's going to go in someone's mouth. Like,
yeah. And so it was infuriating because we already followed probably like 10 times stricter cleanliness regimens than your average household did, you know? Yeah. And the vast majority of COVID contact tracing in the state of Oregon went to retirement homes, which, yes, that was a problem. Churches, schools, and private gatherings, which, again, the governor's not going to crack down on those last three because it scares people, even though it would have been the most efficient thing to do would be to mostly crack down on private gatherings because that's where most of the things came from. and then churches, and then schools. But, you know, those things are unpopular to do. So, again, she's not the science governor. She's the politically expedient governor, and did things that were politically expedient, like attacking bars and restaurants, because that's the most obvious thing you can go after, which, again, was frustrating because we were not the fucking problem. So to answer your question, did our cleaning regimen change? Yeah, a little bit. A couple different chemicals to throw on some certain things. Like, sure, we were washing down doorknobs more often than not.
Yeah.
Because that was the thing we didn't used to have to hit before, because we didn't think about it.
And then we found out that
it didn't really matter.
It didn't even matter because COVID was airborne and not last on surfaces.
Anything, yeah, blah, so blah, blah. Sanitizing the fucking pens the entire time was just a wasted effort of...
Well, but it's not wasted because there is stuff you can get from surfaces. It's just...
Yeah. It wasn't COVID, and COVID was what was killing people.
But it wasn't COVID, right? But it's like... anyway, we suddenly now realize how disgusting people really are. Anyway, so Xander, Barry, back to you. So how did you personally feel like safety? I know in my job, I felt really mostly pretty safe because I due to the nature of my job, I'm able to pretty much be alone for a lot of the time, and I can lock myself in my office or I can work from home.
Sure.
And I'm pretty safe. You are literally working with the public.
Yeah.
How was that for you?
I felt pretty safe for a number of reasons. One is that my company that I work for, McMinimans, gave us a ton of cleaning supplies that were like above and beyond what we normally would have. We had a regimented like hourly like cleaning thing we had to go and do. We had the screens in front of us. Everyone had to wear a mask. And I had the absolute authority to tell someone who wasn't wearing a mask to get the fuck out.
Awesome.
And, you know, I didn't have very many problems with that. I had a handful of them, but for the most part, people were very compliant with that whole thing. McMinimans also went and made their own hand sanitizer.
Oh, yeah.
That was available at every single bar for the public and the employees as well. So we're just like lathering ourselves with that all day long. So I feel like they did a really good job at being able to go and supply us with cleaning stuff, you know, the shield guards and whatnot, obviously the mask mandate unless you were sitting down. And also when it was just, you know, outdoor dining only, it was fine because I work at Edgefield and there's 74 fucking acres of space. We could just tell people to go, like, here's your food and drink, go away now. And then we'd sit out in front of picnic benches that were very socially distanced, and we would not allow them to push them together or anything like that. So I will give kudos to McMinimans for doing the best they had with a bad situation as far as keeping people safe, but also trying to keep people employed.
Mm-hmm. NPC, how have you felt returning to bars and restaurants safety-wise?
Oof, just as I took a sip of that whiskey.
Now you've just sanitized your entire esophageal hallway.
I think my breath is sanitizing this microphone.
That's good. I don't know when the last time we've cleaned these. So
I clean them every couple of weeks. Yeah,
nice. Thank you. The
plates. Anyway, I have felt perfectly fine. I've never actually felt unsafe at the bars. Yeah.
Nice.
Everyone that I went to has been, you know, fantastic with their cleaning regimen. Even the strip club around the corner, the wonderful Pirates Cove, has implemented some amazing safety protocols there. So I'm okay. I've never had a problem going to the bars. Grocery stores have been what have freaked me out the most.
Yeah. Agreed. The grocery stores, and then when we were just in the Central Oregon coast last weekend, I decided to take a trip to the outlet malls just to go do some shopping, get some shoes or whatever. And
rookie mistake.
I did my research. I was there for a specific thing. I was prepared to pay $50 for a pair of Converse wherever I went. It was fine. But I was like, even though it's an outdoor mall, I was like, there's still so many fucking people here. Like, I'm wearing a goddamn mask. There was hardly anybody wearing a mask because the mandates have been lifted. So why the fuck would you wear a mask, right? To which I always reply, I don't have to wear pants either, but I do.
That actually is true in the state of Oregon. If you're not in Oregon, you don't have to wear pants in public if you don't want to.
I
want to
see more people adopt some of the East Asian country protocols where on the regular, it is no thing at all to see people out in public wearing masks.
I'm really hoping that starts to happen more and more in the U.S. Mm-hmm. It's just not a thing to wear a mask.
Yeah.
Like, why are you wearing a mask? You know what? It's none of my fucking business why you're wearing a mask.
Yeah.
I don't like wearing masks.
No. I mean,
unless I'm hijacking a train or kind of damsels of the railroad track, it's just not my bag.
But I like now that I have the option of doing it. And if somebody asks me why I'm doing it, I can just flip them off. Or
be like, yeah. For the same reason I'm wearing pants, to keep my shit off you.
Okay.
I get kind of aggressive.
With your shit?
Well, I get kind of, this is a whole other episode, but I get a little aggressive about people telling me what I should and should not do with my body.
That's a whole other episode.
That's a whole other, I'm just going to leave it. I'm going to leave it at that. That's all I'm going to say.
So, Xander, what's the capacity been lately at McMiniman's?
That's a very complicated question because of the 74-acreness of the entire property. However, we are bringing back our summer concert series as of next month. August 15th is going to be the first show with Sheryl Crow. As far as I know, our capacity is going
She's still alive?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
She's only like 50?
No, I thought she had an overdose or something.
What?
Oh, okay. I don't know. Yeah. Anyways, as far as I know, we're going to keep our capacity as what it was 2 years ago, pre-COVID, which is about 5,000 people per show.
My question actually has specifically focused on how has capacity been in your observation lately? Like, compared to the before times?
It's very strange, actually. So, obviously, a lot fewer people have been there this summer and the summer before that as well, just because we weren't having these 5,000-person concerts and, like, you know, five weddings a day and all that other kind of stuff. However, I've been making more money the last two summers as opposed to pre-COVID summer. I think probably because people just really wanted to get out of the house and we had the outdoor space. And so people were able to go and were just take my money. I'm so happy to be outside the house. And
higher tips.
It was a higher tip percentage. And also there were fewer employees. And so you didn't have to split the tips as much between other people because I was working like 5 days a week, sometimes 6 days a week last summer. And then this summer too, is for that matter.
I think McMiniman's is still hiring and offering hiring bonuses.
They are for cooks. Absolutely. And we're also hiring for bartenders too. So if you want to, you know, be in my department, small bars, and, you know, join in the mayhem, madness, and malarkey, talk to me. Shoot me a message on the Discord.
And that
talk.
Sweet, sweet food credit.
Oh, that's sweet. That new sweet, sweet food credit is the actually mayhem, pretty nice.
Madness, malarkey of McMiniman's. I love it.
That actually used to be my tagline for my original radio show, The Black Rider on 91.9 KCSB.
Mm.
You're listening to The Black Rider, Madness, Mayhem, and Malarkey.
God, we've all previously done radio before we did this, didn't we?
Almost like we know what we're doing.
Yeah, it's almost like we know what we're doing.
Except, do we?
Except mine wasn't like live broadcast. It was.
Oh, mine was.
It was, I did a rabbit hole radio theater in Fort Collins, Colorado. Shout out.
Do you need some more Ghost Rabbit with that thought?
Possibly.
There you go.
It's pretty good, actually.
I need to actually sleep tonight.
Yeah, I'm helping.
No. Alcohol inhibits stage four sleep.
Lies.
Lies and slander, it's lies and slander. You get out of here. Get out. No.
Listen,
no.
You and your fake news.
fake news.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol. Get going. Drink up, then order again.
What do you think of this beverage combination?
I like this. It's good. That whiskey, holy Mary.
It's delicious.
It's potent. Mm. It's potent.
Yeah, the rye from Cornelius Pass Road House, the Billy Rye, is actually quite delightful, which is why I wanted to get this bottle as well for us tonight. Again, it's got that nice kind of pepperiness, a touch of vanilla, that nice subtle oak. It's really good. And also at 100 proof, it does not taste like it. I don't think anyways.
Well, don't we all have a touch of vanilla in us?
God, it's good. Yeah.
It's tasty. It is very tasty. What would you, if you were going to make a cocktail with this rye, Xander, mm-hmm. What would you make?
I think the Billy Rye makes for a lovely Manhattan myself.
Yes. Yeah.
The rye Manhattan, I think, is a little bit underrated. People think Manhattans have to be bourbon. They do not.
Wait. I've never had a bourbon Manhattan. It's only been rye whiskey.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh,
everywhere I've ever been has been rye. Who does bourbon?
Most people.
but they're fucking wrong. They are wrong. Even if you look up the recipe on Google, which I did back in the day to learn how to make a Manhattan, yeah, it says rye whiskey.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Hmm. This also makes for a lovely Sazerac.
I don't know what that is.
New Orleans classic. It's going to be rye whiskey, Peychaud's bitters, maybe a touch of simple, and then like an absinthe. Sorry, an absinthe rinse.
Interesting. Huh.
Yeah, you take a lemon peel as a garnish, you go and express it, pinch the oils over the top of it, and it's a nice, it's kind of made like an old-fashioned.
Xander.
Yeah.
Do you know how to make the fictional beverage Screaming Valkyrie?
Do we know how to make a fake beverage?
There's it is, so this beverage is the MacGuffin plot of an entire episode of Cheers, where they're trying to get rid of a bartender who's too good. So they all start ordering this fictional beverage that they all go in on. They're like, we got to get rid of him. And if he can't make this beverage, we got to fire him. So they all come in and order this thing. And I don't remember if there was actually ever a mix for it, but I'm very curious to know if you can make one.
I know. I'm like, I got to look this shit up. Hold on.
One on my fucking phone right now. Thanks, dipshit. Screaming Valkyrie. Jesus Christ.
Oh, I'm too drunk to type.
It's a cocktail? A supposed cocktail?
Screaming Valkyrie.
Okay, now we're all looking it up. Hopefully I remembered
Valkyrie
it correct.
Valkyrie Hot Toddy.
Like, nothing is coming up.
No.
For, like, alcohol.
No.
Drink? Screaming Valkyrie drink?
I think you just misremembered this.
Nope. Season 6, episode 1. Okay. Yeah. I think I'll have a Screaming Valkyrie. Yep.
Oh my God.
Yep.
Like my Google search is not finding fucking anything. That's amazing. Because Cheers was a very popular show. So yep. I'm surprised that didn't come up on a search. Google, get it, your shit together.
Well, I think it's still on Netflix. If it is, yeah, we'll have to watch Valkyrie. It after this. Yep.
I would imagine a Screaming Valkyrie would be something like Manischewitz.
No.
Goldschlager.
Maybe.
And Jägermeister.
Oh, God.
And Bailey's.
What is wrong with you?
Well, it's a screaming fucking Valkyrie, motherfuckers.
That's no.
That's
no.
It sounds like you are a bad man and you are the friend of a bad man.
I mean, yes. Our doorbell just rang and I have no idea what's going on.
It's probably the cocktail police that throw you in jail.
And on that note,
that's a break Jacob moment.
On that note, you've been listening to Biker's Dice and Bars. We're a little saucy right now, and this is meandering to a close. I'm NPC.
I'm an empty chair.
And the good Dr. Xander Gerrymander.
And I'm Poppy, the screaming fucking Valkyrie, motherfuckers.
And we would like to remind you, keep your shirt set up.
Always tip your bartender.
Always roll the grits.
And please always drink responsibly.
Check us out online, Patreon, Discord, Facebook, Twitter, all the places. Drop by and say hi.
I'm going to go answer the doorbell.
Good night, folks.
Good night.
Thanks for joining us, friend. We've reached the end of Biker's Dice and Bars.